Well, what's up, Harvest? It's good to be in God's house again. Indeed, God is faithful then, and he's faithful now. And I can't wait to get into God's word today. I hope that you are feeling the same. It's amazing to watch God's people come into God's house in the winter when it's over 50 degrees. It's just like something just breaks forth. People just bolting out of their cars. We have the kids are all in service today. It's a fantastic day. My 8-year-old Micah said to me, he said, Daddy, we get to go to big church today. And I said, yeah, man, we get to go to big church today. And he said, Daddy, I just have one question for you. He said, are there any snacks? If you look real close, I'm sure there are some in a few people, but it is just so good to be in God's house. And before we go any further, I want to invite the Lord Jesus to be with us. As I get into the word today, I realize that while it's good to laugh and to be together, the reality is that someone came to church today needing a word from God. And that starts with me. And so I pray that the Lord Jesus would be with us as we get into the text. So if you would, bow your heads with me in a word of prayer. Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to share your word, and thank you so much for the reality that your son Jesus truly is faithful. I pray, God, that the words that I share will be the words that you've given me, nothing more and nothing less, that there would be more of you and less of me. And I pray it in the matchless name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, let me invite you to open your Bibles. If you don't have one, one's been provided for you all around Chicagoland, any of our 6 campuses, and those that are joining us online right now. We are in the Just Jesus, and I love the series that we're in. It's called The Radical Teacher, The Radical Teacher. And so we're in Mark chapter 7. We're going to start at the 24th verse, and we're going to the 37th verse. And I'm using as a title this weekend, Be Opened When Desperation and Faith Meet. Be opened when desperation and faith meet. I want to ask you a question as we get started today. It's a question that I've been pondering all week, and I hope that it's one that will be in your hearts as you go through this week, and it's this. Have you ever had a time in your life when you've been desperate? I don't mean I just was having a problem, Pastor Ed. I'm having a little difficulty. I'm talking about a time in your life when you were desperate, your back was against the wall, you were in trouble, and you needed God. If you're here under the sound of my voice and you've ever been in that place where you've been desperate, can I just see your hands? Thank you. Yeah, all over the room. I believe that many of us have had those times when we're desperate. In fact, maybe that might be you right now. Those times when you look at the bank account and it looks back and waves at you. Those moments where you have issues with your family, or maybe somebody walked out on you and you didn't know what you were going to do. Maybe you were in a situation on your job where you were wrongfully accused and you lost your job because of that. I don't know what the situation is, but there are times in our lives that we're desperate for God. I remember one of those times back in the dark ages, 1987. I was a second year high school student in Des Moines, Iowa, and I was headed back home. And when I got back home, I noticed that everybody was sitting around the living room, but no one was smiling and no one had had dinner. As I proceeded back to the kitchen, I realized that there was nothing in the cabinets and there was nothing in the refrigerator because there wasn't any food in the house. Daddy had been laid off from John Deere, and the reality is that the money was gone and dried up, and we didn't have any food. Somebody say desperate. We were desperate for something in that moment in time. And I remember my dad getting me together, and we went and gathered some bottles and cans together and looked outside and found some and went to the grocery store to redeem them. Some of y'all don't know about that, but 5 cents for a can and 10 cents for a bottle, amen. And we went to the grocery store, and I remember looking at my dad, and he looked proud and he looked strong, and he said, son, I want you to remember this moment that God will provide. But we were desperate. And in this text today, we're going to see a woman and a man who were desperate for God, and we're going to see how their faith helped see them through. And a little bit at the end of the sermon, I'm going to share with you how that story ended in my own family. So to give you a little context of what we're looking at, Jesus has been quite busy and had the 5,000 that he fed, and Pastor Dave Stone shared with us last week a discourse with a private group about what really defiles a person. Is it what's on the outside or on the inside? And he challenged them on some cultural mores and some things that were going on. And the reason why Jesus did that is because he was about to go on a tour with the disciples, and this was the first time and the only time that he went outside of the region of Galilee. This would be a trip that would take actual several weeks, if not months. And he was trying to teach a lesson that the disciples had forgotten. The reality of the lesson that he was trying to teach them is that the gospel of Jesus Christ is for everyone. But the reality is the culture of the Jews and the Gentiles were very separate. And so what we're going to find is we're in the region of Tyre and Sidon. It's this on the north area of Galilee, of Palestine. And Jesus did quite a bit of walking. Some of you might wonder if Jesus was fit and the disciples. Well, this was about 30 to 40 miles northwest of Capernaum, where most of Mark has been taking place. Let's just say that Jesus was walking across the tracks. And across the tracks, there weren't a lot of people who were Jews that resided, although we learned in Mark chapter 3, verses 7 and 8, that people in this region already knew who Jesus was because they had been coming to hear him in some of his preaching and some of his teaching. So we see that Jesus is going on a trip, and he has these men with him. And he's trying to teach them that the gospel of Jesus Christ is for everyone. I'm going to come back to that in a moment. And it brings us to the first point in your notes, is that the gospel is not only good news for me, but the gospel is good news that is meant to flow through me. The gospel is not just good news for me, it is news that should flow through me. And so the text begins, and from there he arose and went away to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And he entered a house and did not want anyone to know, yet he could not be hidden. So we see the reputation of Jesus is already, it already is spread, as I said earlier. The reality is Jesus was just trying to get an Airbnb with some boys and do some teaching. He's trying to get away. He's trying to rest. But he couldn't because the popularity of his message and his person and the miracles that had happened had followed him even to this place. And the text says, immediately a woman whose daughter who had an unclean spirit heard of him and came and fell down at his feet. Immediately, there was not a moment to rest and get settled, but immediately a woman came crying out. She had a serious issue, a mother with a child. How many of you here are mothers, just by a show of hands? Can we just give God thanks for the mothers that are in this place, the way that you care for us and our children? I've learned a few things in my life, and one I've learned is you don't mess with a mother when her child is hurting. You don't mess with a mother when a child is in distress, and this was a serious situation because the Bible says that her daughter was possessed with a demon. This wasn't just I have a common cold or I'm struggling with some tests at school. This is something that I can imagine that this lady, when she came, probably had bags on her eyes, and I'm sure her hair wasn't exactly kept, and she probably had on some tattered clothes. See, I don't know what the situation was, but what we do know is that whatever was going on in that house was very challenging. And the Bible says that she immediately came and had an unclean spirit. In the parallel passage in Matthew chapter 15, which you might want to just write in your notes, Matthew 15 has the same version, but it says something different. She says to Jesus, "Oh Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me." Wait a minute, hold the phones. How does a woman who is from this region, who's not a Jew, know to say, "Oh Lord, Son of David"? Something has happened already in this woman's life without us even hearing from Jesus or hearing from the 12, something has happened in her life to let us know that she knows who Jesus is and in some way is trying to follow what he has. And the Bible continues and shares three things that we learn about her. The first is this: she is extremely humble. It says that she throws and falls down at the feet of Jesus. Just the humble position that she puts herself down. She's very humble. But it's not that she's very humble. She has great clarity in what she is asking. What is it that you need? Well, she says that she actually begged him to take the demon out of her daughter. So it's very clear what she needed. There was not any mincing of words, and she begged out loud. The text in Matthew 15 lets us know that she was begging out loud, so much so that the disciples, get this, this is the disciples, these are the people that Jesus is training. The disciples said, hey, can we just get this lady out of here? Can we just take her away? I mean, she's being a little loud and carrying on about her daughter. Can we get this woman out of the way? Real great compassion, is it not, for the disciples? Not a proud moment. But we need to ask the question, why did the disciples respond this way to this woman? Because Mark gives us a detail in verse 26. It says, now the woman was a Gentile, a Syrophoenician by birth. From a Jewish perspective, Gentiles were often seen as pagans who didn't know the true God. These are people that we don't spend time with, we don't fellowship with, they don't eat the same food, they were disrespectful, they didn't acknowledge the true God. In fact, as you look through the Old Testament, this region that we were discussing earlier is the home of the god Baal. For those that might have been around church a little while, you might know that Baal was idol worship of the most defiling kind. I can't even mention some of the things that Baal worshipers did in front of the temple and in the temple. But let's just say, for family's sake, that the temple was defiled in every way that you possibly could imagine. This is what this people used to do. In 1 Kings chapter 18, you can look at on your own time, we see a showdown between the prophet Elijah and the prophets of Baal. This is where Jezebel, the region that she came from. This is what's going through the minds of the disciples as they're looking at this woman in this region. You don't even have the right to be in this house with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And the Bible says in Matthew chapter 15, in the same account, it says that Jesus doesn't say a word to her. He just listens. How awkward that pregnant silence must have been. How awkward must it have been for a woman to be begging for her child to be healed, and Jesus is saying nothing. I wonder, when we think about Gentiles, we look at this text and we go, oh, that's just terrible. I can't believe that they would treat people that way. I can't believe that they would treat a woman that way who's a Gentile, that is not from their background. Don't they know that Jesus loves everyone? Well, let me ask you a question. Are there parts of town that you drive through and you don't stop because you, in fact, know that it's not a place where people look like you? Is there a part of town that you were told that you shouldn't go to because, well, those people aren't like us? Is there a part of town that you go through that you struggle to know that Jesus Christ actually loves those people the way that he loves you and the people that are in your neighborhood? I don't know about you, but there are times where I find myself in our culture wondering, is Jesus really here? I remember when I was thinking about Harvest Bible Chapel and coming to Harvest Bible Chapel as a pastor, and I had some people that were calling me, and they said, hey, Pastor Ed, just want to let you know we're praying for you, you know anything about Harvest Bible Chapel? Is it a place that an African-American would feel comfortable and be able to worship God in spirit and in truth? And that was my white friends that called me. and ask that question. They wanted to know, is Harvest serious about racial reconciliation and taking the gospel to all people of every ethnicity and every culture? Are they serious about the mission that they have in Matthew 28, 19 and 20, that we're to go to all the nations and preach the gospel and make disciples? Well, I'm here to tell you under the sound of my voice that Harvest Bible Chapel is for everybody. Harvest Bible Chapel is for white people. It's for black people, it's for Latinos and Indians and Asians. It's for immigrants, it's for people who are internationals. It's for people who are rich or poor, broke. This is for everybody. The gospel of Jesus Christ is for everyone. If that's not the church you're looking for, then you can pray for us and we won't see you next week. That's the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the reason why Jesus wanted the disciples to go on this tour, it was not to do miracles. It was not to necessarily be on retreat. It was because he wanted to remind them that this is the reason why I came. This is the reason why I came. Isaiah chapter 42. I just want to read a couple verses out of Isaiah 42. Listen to what Isaiah prophesied would happen when the Messiah came. Behold, my servant whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him, and he will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry aloud or lift up his voice or make it heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and a family burning wick he will not quench. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not grow faint or be discouraged till he has established justice in the earth. Jesus wanted the disciples to know that the gospel, I'm here because I am here to give the gospel to the Jews who've rejected the Lord. But it's not to stop there. I'm doing it and I'm discipling you because I need you guys to get it, because you're going to take it to the world after I'm gone. That is the whole reason why Mark put this section of scripture in the Bible. Jesus is trying to teach them a lesson. Paul takes it even further in Romans chapter 1, verse 16. He says that I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Why am I not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ? Because it's the power unto salvation to those who believe, to everyone who believes. But then look at that little phrase at the end of the verse. It says, first to the Jew and then to the Greek. So there was an order to the strategy that Jesus had. But as we get back to the text, we find out that she's a Syrophoenician by birth. Syrophoenician is just the region, is Phoenicia. That was the region. It was Roman rule, and it was near Syria, the larger country. So she was a Syrophoenician by birth. And she begged him to cast out the demon from her daughter. And he said to her, look at what Jesus says. Let the children be fed first, for it is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs. Point two, as we gasp in that verse. When I place my focus on Jesus, my circumstances get smaller, but his power becomes greater. When I place my focus on Jesus, my circumstances get smaller, but his power becomes greater. Verse 27 brings a conundrum for some of us that we need to pause, because I don't want anybody to walk out of church saying, Pastor Ed said that women were dogs. That is not what the Bible is communicating. But let's talk about what verse 27 is saying. Jesus answers finally after being silent for a while, and he says, would it be right for bread to go to the dogs before going to the children. The bread symbolizing here, he's speaking in a parable. The bread being the gospel, the message of life. He came and his sole purpose was to bring the gospel to those who were Jewish, who had not believed. His purpose was that that same gospel would be spread, thus the reference of the crumbs, to the rest of the world and to the nations. But he's in this parable offering a test. The test is this: how does she see herself? She's already said that he is Lord. She's already said in the Matthew account that she knows that he's the Son of God. But the question now is, should I stop my focus and bring this to you and the Gentiles when I am not ready to go yet? There's still a year and a half left of ministry. I'm getting these 12 ready. And the 12 also heard this same thing. I love how Jesus asks questions that penetrate our hearts. And so this was not a disrespect. The word dogs translated here in the Greek, there are two different ways that this word is translated. One, and the one that was more often used, is an adult, angry, vicious dog. It was used as, unfortunately, among the Jews, as a disrespect to those who were Gentiles. They were often called dogs. It was not the way that Jesus was translating and using this. He actually was using the other translation, which is one of like puppies, just puppies around the table that would be around. He's just saying, hey, is it wise that I would give the bread first to the dogs and not to the people? I ask you the question. Some of you are dog lovers. My forgiveness to the cat lovers. There's grace for you in heaven. I'm sure I'll get a few texts on that this week. But if you were at the table and mama and daddy were bringing dinner, would they give the food first to the dogs and let the dogs eat and then bring the scraps to the people at the table? No. And so Jesus was offering this to test her faith. And notice, their circumstance hasn't changed yet. She still has a daughter at home who's possessed with a demon. But something happens in this text that I love. There's something that we see in this incredible woman. She shows incredible persistence. She shows a determination. This is one of my favorite ladies in Scripture. I don't know her name, but I'm just going to call her Keisha for the sake of the sermon. Keisha just had some swag. She was not going to go away. She was not going to allow anything to deter her today because her daughter was at home. Keisha knew that she was in the presence of Jesus. She knew that Jesus could heal. I don't know where she found out that information, but maybe she was in the 5,000 that were fed. Maybe she had heard the message from somebody else, or she knew someone who had been healed or touched by Jesus. But whatever the point is, she answered him in verse 28 in a legendary response to Jesus Christ. But she answered him, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." I'm desperate. I need you, but I need you to know that even the dogs under the table, they can get some crumbs. She had a mic drop moment with Jesus Christ. In that moment, she responded back and said, "Listen, I know that it's coming to the Gentiles eventually. All I'm asking is, can right now I have just some crumbs? Can I get a morsel for my daughter? Because we're desperate." And I think for some of us, we get right to the point in prayer where God is getting ready to answer and we give up. We don't have persistence in humility. Persistence and humility are the brother and sister that help empower you to be able to live the Christian life. That you have to seize it. You have to go after it. You have to crave more of Jesus Christ. And in this moment, in her response, what she showed is that she understood, I'm not asking for a position at the table. I'm not asking for rights. I'm just asking to be under the table. I'm just asking for a crumb, Lord, because my daughter needs to be healed. I don't know about you. Have you begged and asked God like that? It reminds me of a character in the Bible. For those that maybe haven't been around on church world, there's a guy, his name is Jacob, in Genesis chapter 32. And Jacob was a hot mess, like many of us. Jacob was a conniver. He was a schemer. The dude stole his birthright from his older brother. I mean, the dude was a mess. And God got a hold of him. And one day he was going back to Canaan, trying to get home, and he sent some gifts to his brother, trying to appease and soften this arrival, and it wasn't going over very well. And he begged and pleaded with God to save him and his family. And the Bible says that God came and visited him in the evening in the form of an angel, and the Bible says that Jacob wrestled with the angel all night. He wrestled with him and he said, I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. I'm not going to let go. I am going to hold on to you until you bless me. And an amazing thing happened. The angel, I think, just got tired. He's just, listen, man, this dude is not going to let go. And the Bible says he touched his hip and threw his hip out. That's the only way the wrestling match stopped. And for the rest of Jacob's life, he walked with a limp. Why? Because it was a reminder that he wrestled with God. He wasn't going to let go until he blessed him. And God changed Jacob's name to Israel. I wonder how many of us, God is waiting for us to wrestle with him so he could change our name. I wonder how many of us would wrestle with him in this way. I love the way that David English explained this tension and the words that I just have been sharing about the woman and her request to Jesus. He said, surely the bread would go to the children, but what of the crumbs as they drop to eat? He doesn't need to be deflected from his main mission to the Jews in order to do something to her daughter. The reality is, God never gives up on us, and we shouldn't give up on God. Never give up on God, because he most assuredly would never give up on you. In James 4:6, it says, but he gives grace. Therefore, it says, God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the what? He gives grace to the humble. There's something about when we humble ourselves unto God that he hears us. And so we're challenged by the Syrophoenician woman and her example, but we're also challenged by Jesus, because Jesus is engaging her. He's a rabbi. You're not supposed to do this. They both are crossing barriers that are untold, unheard of. And Jesus responds to her faith. And look at what the Bible says in verse 29 and 30. And he said to her, for this statement, you may go your way. The demon has left your daughter. And she went home and found the child lying in bed and the demon gone. I could just shout and run around this church right now just hearing those words. Did you notice what just happened there? He healed her daughter and she hadn't even left yet. He healed her daughter and she hadn't even started to head home yet. He healed her daughter and she didn't ask another question. Why? Because he connected with her faith. In Matthew 15, it says that she had great faith, mega faith. And when Jesus saw her faith and then he saw her humility, he's, girlfriend, your daughter is, she is healed. The demon is gone. You can go on home. Do what you got to do. It's all good. That's the translation according to Pastor Ed. And so she goes home, and can you imagine seeing her daughter laying in bed peacefully? Not writhing and screaming. The first night in probably ages that they had a restful sleep. Well, Jesus had to get out of town. And so he returned to the region of Tyre and went through Sidon, which, by the way, this is not a direct route. This is about 120 miles that Jesus and the disciples were walking. But he says that he was in the region of Decapolis, which is about a band of 10 cities that are in that region. And they brought to him a man who was deaf and had a speech impediment. And they begged him to lay his hand on him. And taking him aside from the crowd privately, he put his fingers into his ears, and after spitting, he touched his tongue. Let me just stop right there, because I know some of your faces are already looking a little turned. How many of you here under the sound of my voice are germaphobes? Yeah. Just want you all to know, Jesus loves you, but none of y'all were going to get healed that day. For all the germaphobes, y'all would have missed this completely. In fact, I love this text because it reminds me of how different we are sometimes in relationship to the times. I mean, Jesus Christ put his hands and his fingers in someone's ear. How do you put your fingers in someone's ear? And then to double it down, he spit on his hand and touched the man's tongue. The question is, if I called you up right now and spit and put... But it brings me to point number three. When I choose to get low, my faith tends to grow. When I choose to get low, my faith tends to grow. See, we laugh because we're like, ain't nobody doing that to me. But see, the thing is, Jesus can do whatever he wants to do to you because he's the Lord. And it's interesting that this man could not hear and he couldn't speak. And some friends brought him to Jesus. Aren't you glad when friends bring you to Jesus? They have the wisdom that they can't do it, but they know who can. And so they bring the man to Jesus, and the Bible says that he does all this. And I love our church because y'all send me some interesting messages after preaching sometimes. And someone sent me a picture that I sent to Pastor Dave. This was after he spoke on feeding the 5,000. And they said, you know, I don't know if many of us would be healed this day if it was like this. As you can see on the screen, y'all would be asking all kind of questions when Jesus is trying to perform his miracles. Is it mercury free? Is it gluten free on the bread? I mean, where'd y'all get the fish? We don't see that this man is asking any of those questions, amen? All he's doing is responding to what Jesus is doing. But there's a little part that we learned that Jesus does in this. It says he takes him away privately. He takes him away privately and has this intimate moment as he is healing him. I love the sensitivity that Jesus has. Do you believe that Jesus could have spoke the word and the man be healed? Absolutely. But for some reason, Jesus chose to physically engage this man's faith. And he said one word, epitha. Epitha in Greek means be opened. It didn't take a lot of words for Jesus to do what he needed to do. He just said be opened. And the Bible says, and his ears were open, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. There wasn't any doubt that Jesus Christ was on the scene. He actually did what no one else could even imagine. He could hear clearly and he could speak. And then one of the most amazing things in the text cracks me up. We were talking about it late last night, that after all this happens, what's the first thing that you would do if Jesus allowed you to speak clearly and hear clearly? What's the first thing that you would do? I'd go tell everybody. I'd be on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. I mean, just telling everybody. I'd be doing a live stream. I'm right here. Jesus Christ is down the street. He told me not to say anything, but I'm here to tell you it was him. He put his hands on me. He put his fingers in my ear. I mean, the brother spit. I know it's nasty. And he touched my tongue, and I'm just telling everybody now. But Jesus said, y'all need to slow your roll. Be quiet. Don't tell anybody. It's not time for me to go to the cross. There's other things that need to be done. And the people heard him and did exactly what he said. Is that what the text says? No. It says that the people, as soon as he told them that, the people more zealously proclaimed it. And they were astonished beyond measure, saying, he has done all things well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak. I don't know about your desperation, but as I look at the story of this woman and this man, it brings to mind one quote. God can use your private pain for his public praise. God could use what you privately are suffering through for his public praise. Yeah, I know he walked out on you and he left you and he divorced you. And God can use it for his glory. I know that you lost the job that you thought was yours, and God can use that for his glory. I know that you are in a situation with a child who is far from Christ, but God can use that for his glory. I know you go to a church that is frequently in the news and has gone through a few issues, but God can use that for his glory. I know that you have gone through some things in your life where you've been overlooked and people thought that you were something that you were not and you've been falsely accused, but God can use it for his glory. He can take your private pain and use it for his public praise. The question is, do you have faith? Because faith honors God, and God honors faith. Faith honors God, and God honors faith. Harvest, you weren't given the word of God because you needed to get spiritually more full. You weren't given the word of God so that you could just marinate it on yourself and have your personal soul salvation. You were given the word of God because people were faithful generations ago, and they allowed the word to be used through them to be a blessing to others. And we have communities that are waiting for you to show up. We have neighbors that are waiting for you to show up. We have situations and businesses and dreams that God is waiting for us to show up with the gospel of Jesus Christ so that we can be a blessing to others. We started today about my story of desperation. I want to tell you how it ended up. Came home and we prayed for the food. It was one pack of cinnamon rolls, I remember. A jug of not quite juice, not quite Kool-Aid, I don't even know what it was. It said 10% juice on the label. And a pack of bologna. I didn't eat the bologna then, and I don't eat the bologna now. I hate it. But we prayed, and Daddy said, you might not get any food, but we served it to everybody. And then there was a knock on the door about 5 minutes later, and I heard somebody footsteps running off the porch. I went to the door with my dad, and we didn't see anybody, just some footprints. But on the porch, there were bags and bags of groceries. Bacon, eggs, chicken. I would love to say that my thought was to pause and pray and give God thanks. Your boy wanted to grab the bags and get them in the house as fast as they could. But my dad grabbed me and he said, wait a minute. I want everybody to come to the door. We all came to the door, and he said, I told you that God will provide. We prayed for the food. Daddy said, boy, get those groceries in the kitchen. God is faithful then. And God is faithful now. And the question for us as a church today, as we go into this week, is will your faith and desperation meet in a place that will lift the name of Jesus even higher? Let's pray and give God thanks for what he shared with us today. Father, thank you so much for your goodness, and thank you so much for your word. Thank you so much for the boldness of taking the gospel to the nations, of which we are a benefit. You've been faithful then, and you've been faithful now. So we, together, we speak to our fear, and we preach to our doubt that you've been faithful then, and you again are faithful now. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and respond to the Lord Jesus in worship.